Well, it is good to be with you today. And just wanted to kind of give you a bit of an FYI. Today is going to look a little different. One of the reasons it's going to be different, we actually recorded our worship time under the big tent in our backyard here. And so we just had an opportunity where people could join us in song, and we recorded that and used some of those songs for our broadcast. Another reason why today is a little different is that you're going to see a video really as kind of a bit of a testimony to Elaine and her ministry. Today is her last day here at FBC. And so I'm actually sitting on a bench that Nathan made. So next week, my daughter is going to be marrying my new-to-be son-in-law, Nathan, and we are very excited about that. But it also means a change for us. And I just wanted to say, it's a little easier to do it on camera than in person, but I just want to say, Elaine, it has been an utter joy, not just having you as my daughter, but also having my daughter work with me. You are so gifted and so talented, and we love you so much, and I've enjoyed every moment working with you. And one of the things that we try to do here at FBC, if you're on staff here, we want you to try and memorize the book of 2 Timothy. And one of the reasons that we do that, it really speaks to the challenges, the pressure, but it drives our heart home to the gospel. And so Elaine, you guys can all listen in, but this is mainly to Elaine. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, where Paul says, "You then, my son," I'll put their daughter this time, "be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." We need to be doing all that we can to grow in the gospel, but we also need God's grace. And that's why you'll see not too far down, just a few verses later, Paul will bring the gospel right back into the conversation. "Remember Christ Jesus, raised from the dead, the descendant of David. This is my gospel for which I'm suffering, even to the point of being chained." And the book goes on like that. So Elaine, I would just encourage you to keep growing in your love for the gospel and let that permeate all that you put your hand to that God allows you to do. So thank you, Elaine. We love you and you will be missed, but you're not going to get away from us that closely. We're going to stay in close contact, and I'm sure you still will be with our church family as well. But God bless.
Shadow where I hide, the rest. special guest today. Elaine, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, and I thought we would just ask Elaine some questions. Mm-hmm. So, Elaine, are you up for this?
I think I'm ready.
No, she doesn't know all these questions, so we'll see what she comes up with. Okay, Elaine, question one. What is your favorite Bible story?
My favorite Bible story is when Paul is in prison and he's just kind of hanging out and the door is just open. And I think that's
okay,
really
cool. Okay, that was awesome. Okay, yeah. Here's one. You have to really think back a long time ago. Sitting in church as a child, as all these FBC kids are, was it easy or hard?
Oh, no. Well, some of the time it was easy, but I do remember a couple of times when I was allowed to sit with my friends and we were making some noise, and later mom pulled me aside and was like, that's not acceptable and that's not okay. So I had my bad moments.
I do remember that was, you guys were really loud.
We were really loud and we were like poking each other. And we were at the very front. We got in big trouble.
Okay, yeah, big trouble. Okay, next one. This has to do with KFBC TV that we did in the spring and into the summer. What was your favorite costume that you got to wear?
That's a good one. I think it was the Easter one with the bunny costume where I took my blanket and I put the ears on because one, very warm because I love my blanket, and two, it was just cool.
Okay, cool. I do remember that.
I hopped in.
Where do you like to read your Bible? Do you have a special spot or do you just kind of do it wherever?
It kind of depends on where I am. So if I'm at home, normally, I know I say don't normally do this. Sometimes I do it in my bed. Sometimes I do it in the living room. But when I was at camp, I used to do it in the laundry room on top of the dryer because it was warm. I turned the dryer on, I'd sit on it, and I was warm.
Okay, I don't think I do that.
Yeah. Okay. Or I do it in the closet.
You can't do it at our house because we have a stackable.
We have a stackable. I have to be on top of the roof to do that.
Okay, now you've been packing up your stuff at the house.
I have.
What do you have too much of?
Oh, gracious me, I have too many clothes. I have so many because I love to go thrift store shopping, so I feel no guilt in buying more things. So.
Okay. Bible camp this summer, when we did, remember the amazing adventure at the amusement park?
I do.
You did some crazy songs with your staff. Did the woodpecker song, the motorcycle song, and the theme song. Which one was your favorite?
I didn't like the theme song one because I got so tired by the end. If you watch the video, I am like huffing and puffing like, but my favorite was the woodpecker because that was just a lot of fun. Yeah.
The woodpecker song. Okay, yeah, that was one of my favorites too. Okay, this summer and into the spring, what was your favorite memory on camera? So either KFBC TV or day camp this summer, your favorite memory?
Oh, that's a good question. I would say either my birthday video that really warmed my heart, or club swinging with the staff. Also a highlight.
Do you want to just show us real quick? There we go, club swinging. Yes. It was an Olympic sport.
It was. Probably not the way we did it, but it was an Olympic sport.
My favorite KFBC TV was your birthday one. And I love it how you came up with your blanket on, and then it's like you pulled off,
it's my birthday!
And the very last question we have to ask you, this goes back a long time.
Ooh.
Who was your favorite Sunday school teacher, and why?
Ooh, good question. All right, I'm gonna see if I can get the name. This was when I was like 6 or 7. Her name was Teresa.
Teresa, yeah,
Teresa.
That's it.
And the reason she was my favorite is because every single Sunday she'd bring us those gold coins and we got to eat the chocolate gold coin and then take the gold wrapper and put it up on a poster board and we were making the road in heaven with gold coins. Oh, and I remember that to this day. Yeah, she's my favorite. She actually is the one who led me to the Lord.
Awesome. Okay, now kids, don't expect gold coins every week because we cannot hand them out to you right now.
No.
Elaine, it has been awesome having you here.
Thank you.
And I guess, kids, we'll see you next week.
Hey, Elaine, with you getting married next week and this being your last Sunday with us as Community Outreach and Camp Director at FBC, we reached out to some members and asked them to share some memories and some parting words with you. I gotta say for myself, I was really impressed with how you stayed positive this past year with all the weird curveballs that were thrown your way. It's not an easy year at all to do outreach or camp, but you really did an awesome job in all the online camps and broadcasts that you did for Kids FBC. Although this is not the year that most people would have wanted or planned, especially with planning a wedding, without it, we never would have gotten to see some of your remarkable creativity, like some of these following videos. Ha ha!
Happy CCV with Mrs. Eleanor.
Hey, kids!
Our family will always remember your crazy, silly, fun, energetic videos from KFBC TV and Camp FBC. Back to you, Alenka.
We love you, Miss Elaine. We'll miss you.
Hi, Elaine. We haven't really gotten to know you for a super long time, but what we do know about you is that you are so devoted to kids ministry. You make everybody laugh, and you're so much fun, and we know the kids have really enjoyed watching you and just being part of your classes. And really, all we wanted to say was,
we are going to miss you!
Bye!
Oh, hi, Elaine! I just wanted to say thank you for all the awesome memories and laughs over the years, along with the great fashion advice. I'm really gonna miss you. Bye!
One thing we love about Elaine is that she taught us cool songs. Once a little green frog one day. Once a little green frog. Once a little green frog one day. So we all went, but we know frogs go. Alaida, alaida, alaida. We know frogs go. Alaida, they'll go. Bye, Elaine. Bye, Elaine.
Hi, Elaine. Congratulations. And my favorite part was hanging out with you and making pom-poms with you last year.
Hey, Elaine, congratulations, yes. And one of my favorite parts, I think, was just hanging out with you after the program, like in where we were downstairs with the rest of the kids. And happy wedding.
Congratulations on your marriage, Nathan and Elaine. You two are a great team. One piece of advice, never go to bed angry and be quick to forgive.
This is some girls from Nathan. Dear Nathan, deep, big Nathan, Miss Elaine.
I'm going to read a poem from Ruth. Elaine. To a very special lady that is young and vibrant and spiritual, a person I could call my daughter, and I will. God bless you through the coming years of marriage. I'll miss your smiles and hugs, every which way, sideways, front, or COVID. Just keep practicing lots of hugs. Remember, each day is a gift from our Father in heaven. Love, Ruth Yonti.
Thank you. Well, good morning, and thank you for taking the time to join us on our broadcast. And I'm in a different spot again today where we're recording. And today I'm in the portable at FBC, and this is where a lot of our camp has happened. And this is actually the backdrop that we use for many of our Camp FBC videos. And one of the reasons for doing that, as you've probably already seen from the previous videos, is that today is the last day for Elaine, our camp director and community director. And so we're obviously really sorry to see her go, and just thought it would be kind of a cool thing to do a broadcast here today. Well, as we begin our message today, I have to admit that this series on church purity, aka church discipline, is not exactly the easiest series for a pastor to preach. In fact, for me, just to say the phrase church discipline, it feels awkward, right? It just kind of makes you want to feel it, say it fast. Your church discipline, you know, just try to get it out there really quick. But it is an important truth that the Bible teaches. And here's the deal. If you want a church to function the way God designed it to function, you have to use the God-ordained method to correct it when things go wrong. But before we begin to look at that this morning, let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we can spend together. I thank you for those that have tuned in to listen to this. I thank you for the church. I thank you, Lord, that we are part of the body of Christ. We are the bride of Christ. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would just help us in our desire to have walks worthy of who you've called us to be. Lord, help me to speak clearly. And Lord, this is not easy doctrine to teach, but just help our minds and our ears and our hearts to be open to your word. We just thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is the last in our three-part series on church purity. And today, as we conclude the series, I want to basically try to answer two questions. First off, I want to answer the question, well, what's the benefits? Like, what are the benefits if we as a church really commit to practicing church discipline? And lastly, we want to ask the question or answer the question, whose job is it to actually perform church discipline? But before we answer any of those questions, I just want to ask you a question. Have you ever noticed that this is not a topic that you hear about too often in church circles, right? And have you ever wondered why? Well, I think, at least in part, the reason that we don't see church discipline widely practiced is because how church discipline has been practiced over the years. I found this really interesting when I came across Mark Dever's book, Nine Marks of a Healthy Church. Great book, thumbs up. But he basically gave the history of church discipline. Now, I've been part of the Fellowship of Evangelical Baptist Churches, I think, for over 30 years. Great denomination, love it. But I have to admit, I only recall one church going down this route in all those years. And that was when I was part of a church where the pastor was actually, he was raised and theologically trained in another continent. But church historians tell us, and these are American stats, but basically pre-Civil War days in the U.S., that church discipline was actually practiced widely. It was very common, and it was done right. It was practiced biblically. Then it seemed about, you know, say two generations ago, church discipline began to be practiced to the extreme, right? For silly reasons, illegalistic issues, people just calling other people out for dumb things. And so now what's happened, the pendulum has kind of swayed to the other extreme, where churches never practice church discipline. And what we saw was churches no longer striving for purity, but I would say maybe rather striving for kind of smooth sailing. So in the past, church discipline was practiced, and then it was abused, and now I would say now that it has pretty much been forgotten. And so maybe you're sitting there thinking, well, why should we try to revitalize something like church discipline, right? After all, since most churches in our culture don't practice it, is it really worth kind of going against the grain on this one? Especially if you have a church that is growing and there's lots of programs, why would you rock the boat? Well, why rock the boat and let things slide? Well, let's be clear that there are certainly a number of reasons why a church shouldn't practice church discipline. For example, if a church is doing it to be controlling, that's bad, or vindictive, you know, clearly Scripture says that's not a good plan. For example, Romans 12:19, beloved, never avenge yourselves, right? But leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. But again, I ask the question, why practice church discipline? It's hard on everybody. If you do practice it, you know, more likely than not, it's going to be seen as being judgmental, or it's going to be seen as being vindictive. And let's face it, some people have abused it. They've done it for silly reasons. But on the other hand, if the DNA of a healthy church is one that, you know what, we are all for the Word of God. And you know what, we are committed that we're going to act on it regardless how we feel. And that's going to drive our behavior. Well, you know, if you remember our biblical counseling videos, we learned that feelings are good, but feelings are never to be the ruling thing. So when it comes to church discipline, we have to believe that it is still should be the practice for today's church. And that, you know what, we believe that there's going to be a good result, even if the process is difficult, even if it's painful. So now what I want to do is really look at the benefits of church discipline. And again, full disclosure, much of this comes from the outline from Mark Dever's book. But the Bible makes it clear that the goal of church discipline, you always got to remember this, the goal is always restoration. But in terms of benefits of church discipline, I have to say this, typically the person who's kind of being called out, when they're going through it, they're likely going to be the last person that's going to say, oh, there is some benefit to this. That's usually not how it works. Usually, unless that person, when they're called out, unless they see it, their eyes are open, they repent from it, likely what you're going to see is this person is going to be pretty upset, they're going to be mad, and they're going to be hurt. And so when all that starts to play out, it's really hard to convince them that, hey, I'm doing this for your benefit. But regardless of whether or not the person that's under discipline responds positively, you need to understand that what we are doing is really for their benefit. Think of it as what we're trying to do is give a wake-up call. It's like they have, in their sin, they have dug themselves into a pit, and we're basically giving them a lifeline out, handing them a rope to climb out of that pit. And so this process is calling them to see. It's pleading with them to stop pretending that they're still walking with God. We're basically saying, hey, you need to understand, there is a problem here. You know, the Bible makes it really clear, and this is so scary, and I see this, and it comes up often, but one of the scary things about sin is it has this an incredibly blinding effect on those who are caught in it. We in this series had looked at 1 Corinthians 5, and you know, that guy that there that was having sex with his stepmom thought it was okay. You know, if you look at the book of Galatians, you learn that the people of Galatia were at a point where they believed into a doctrinal lie. And basically they said, you know, it's okay to trust in our works to save us. If you read 1 Timothy chapter 1, Alexander and Hymogenus, they thought, oh, you know what? It's going to be, we could be blaspheme God, and it's still going to work out good. Sin has a blinding effect. Because what's going on is, as we yield to it, our affections shift. So now, rather than pursuing Jesus, rather than pursuing his righteousness, our affections shift. Now we're starting to fall in love with our sin. It's an issue of the heart, right? Something in their life has become an idol. There is something in their life that has become more important to them than God. And when that happens, I'm telling you, Satan has like a green card to cause destruction and pain, because he has successfully convinced that person that that person's desires, that person's feelings, that trumps the word of God. And now their life begins to be viewed, right, through the lens of their desires rather than through the lens of righteousness and what does Christ want for me. That's why the scripture, when it's describing sin, you can go through it, it will use terms like blinded, hardened, or warped. 2 Timothy, Paul would say they have been taken captive to do the will of Satan. And so we can't change people. We need to understand that we can't change their heart. But we do want them to help see that, you know, they're on a dangerous road. We need to warn them. And so that's why confronting sin is hard stuff. But we're a family, right? And we do hard things out of love for God and also for our love for our church family. Church discipline warns the person. It warns them, hey, friend, you're on a horrible journey. This is not going to go well for you. But it's also worth mentioning that another significant benefit of church discipline is it serves as a warning to other Christians. Galatians 6, verse 1, I love this verse. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression or caught in a sin, right, you who are spiritual should restore him, and listen to this, in a spirit of gentleness. And then it kind of changes. It says, keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. So Paul tells them, hey, guys, this is what you need to do. But he says, you got to watch the attitude behind it. You got to do it in gentleness. And then he gives the motive to be gentle. Realize, friend, it's only because of God's grace that what is happening is not happening to us. Because it could have been us that have fallen. It's reality check time for us when all of this starts to go down. And so we daren't think that we are any better than those who have fallen. I'm telling you that none of us, including pastors, are really that far away from totally messing up our lives. I believe it is unbelievably easy to create a narrative in our heads that justify our hardened heart condition. So next week, that person that finds themselves trapped in sin could be us. Remember the essence of sin, right? It's a thought, it's a word, it's an action that is contrary to the authority of Jesus Christ. And we all sin, right? This is not a call to perfection. We all sin. But really, here's the thing. The turning point is if we sin, but we ignore it. We refuse to turn from it. When that happens, I'm telling you, things, our affections get messed, right? It messes with our heart. And so then what happens? Well, to allow our sin to survive, we got to develop affections that are contrary to God. Oh, I have seen the victim card played over and over and over again. People coming up with all sorts of excuses to justify making unbiblical choices. And often what this victim card looks like, well, you don't understand what happened to me, or my needs are such and such. And so it's okay for me to do such and such. And we become a genius at creating a narrative that justifies us doing what we want to do and when we want to do it. So when we call someone out for going down a bad road, yes, it warns them. Yes, it's like handing them a rope to try to get them out of the pit. It grieves us, but it also warns us. Reminds us that we routinely need to be calling out to God. Search our hearts, oh God. The psalmist David, right? He knew, he was a man after God's own heart, but I'm telling you, he knew what sin looked like and the devastating results that came from it. And he didn't want to go there again. Psalm 139, verses 23, 25. Listen to this. What a prayer this could be for us. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there's any grievous way in me and lead me in the way of everlasting. So church discipline, it tries to help the person who's making poor choices. It helps us individually by warning us. But there's also a corporate benefit as a church as a whole, because another benefit to church discipline is that it purifies the church. Going back to that 1 Corinthians 5 passage, do you remember what Paul's argument was? It really was a motivator to deal with what was going on. Paul basically told them, if you don't deal with your sin, it has this corrupting influence on the body. And this is verse 6 of 1 Corinthians 5. He says, your boasting is not good. Do you know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Paul is basically reminding them of a truth that they already knew, but they were failing to practice. Paul's example, he was giving them an example that would really resonate with them, because they would understand that a little yeast could penetrate the whole batch of dough. Kind of like maybe for us, a small infection can potentially kill a person, right? So the need for church discipline is based on that same principle, in that church discipline protects the church. You know, when you talk of a motivating reason for church discipline, I think one of the most compelling reasons for church discipline is how it's a witness to our world around us. Again, don't get me wrong, when the world sees us, they're never going to see perfection, right? But what they should see is a desire to serve Christ, a desire to reflect His holiness. You know, we do a lot here at FPC to serve our community, and I love that so much. It really means so much to me. But all of those gains would be lost if they don't see our lives as being different. It won't matter a lot if you know, we've got all this to offer people, but they don't see that we love others. And they don't see that we're willing to do the tough things for other people. Again, we're not asking, they won't see perfection. But what they should see is desire to be more like Christ, desire to live a holy life. And to do that, not even just for the reputation of FBC or whatever church you go to, but here's the thing, we want to do it for God's reputation. A couple passages to kind of shine light on that. Matthew 5, verse 16. Jesus said this, he says, in the same way, let your light, right, shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. It's your light shining, right? Peter gave this challenge in 1 Peter 2:12. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable. Why? So that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds. And this is what happens, and glorify God on the day of visitation. It's really simple, right? Our lives are to put the character of God on display. Our world is watching us, they are. And we need to put the character of God on display. Well, you know, Dever in his book makes it clear that church discipline, it's not to be the focal point of the church. That's not where we're going with any of this. It's no more than the medicine is to be the focal point of life. But there are times, like medicine, that it does need to happen. So now the question is, okay, whose job is it to make it happen? Whose job is it to discipline people in the church? You may say, well, it's your job, buddy. It's the pastor's job. Maybe it's the job of the church leaders. And yes, we do have a role in it. But here's the thing, it's not primarily our job. Yeah, do we teach about the theology of it? Yeah, absolutely. you know, pastors are called to be protectors of the flock. So we identify behavior that is contrary to Scripture. And yes, leaders are encouraged to in the practice of church discipline. But here's the thing, the implementation of it, and this might surprise you, it's not just a pastor thing. It's not just a church leader thing. It is the responsibility of the local church as a whole to implement it. Repeatedly, Scripture calls the church as a whole to do it. So again, when the Bible tells us to do something, right, we need to do it, even though it's difficult, because obedience to the Word of God will bring glory to His name. Theologians have summarized that when a church fails to practice church discipline, this is what it's like. And one said, a church without discipline would hardly be counted as a church. Another said this, when discipline leaves a church, Christ goes with it. You know, I have said before that I believe that God just doesn't want FBC to survive. He wants us to thrive, right? And one of the reasons, this might seem like a bit of an add-on, but it's not. I think one of the reasons why I believe that church membership is so important, which I have to admit is a hard sell in our culture. Think of it. It's, you know, we are fiercely independent. We've got this mindset that we want to get the most benefit and make the least commitment. So we are, all of us, very consumer-oriented. But I believe, even though this is very counterculture, I believe church discipline actually makes one of the most compelling reasons to be a member of a gospel-focused church. Right, because think of it. If you become a member, it means, okay, we are agreeing on some fundamental truths. Yeah, okay. And we are agreeing that how these truths are going to affect our behavior. But it goes deeper, right? Because we're also agreeing that, okay, I understand that when I become a member, I'm going to be held accountable to a biblical standard, not perfection, right? But to a biblical standard. And we want to also do our part to hold others accountable. See, that's why a church is so different than joining a club or an organization. We are the bride of Christ. We are the body of Christ. And by God's design, we need each other. And it is not easy. Friends, we are in a war. And a lot of that battle comes from within us, right? And so we need each other at times to help us to live in a way that Christ has called us to live. And so when someone goes astray, we're not condemning them. Our goal is, remember, restoration. We're not perfect. And we're not going to church discipline perfectly. But I know this. When we as believers try to keep others at arm's length, you know what I mean. Right? If you're doing this, you know exactly what I mean. Here's the thing. You are becoming increasingly comfortable in doing your own thing. And when that happens, you're an easy mark. Satan can very easily begin to increasingly change your affections and draw you away from making Christ's desires your desires. You know, here's the thing. Jesus defeated sin and death on the cross, right? And so we know, the Bible teaches, when we believe on Him as our Lord and Master, things change, right? We are no longer children of darkness. We are children of light. Change, right? Following Christ is about change on so many different levels. Not just a change in our eternal destiny, because we were heading for hell and now we are destined for heaven. Our character begins to change. Our affections begin to change. Our desires begin to change. And we need each other to help us in that process. And church discipline is one of the ways that we do that. You know, our culture has adopted some interesting ways to bring about change, haven't they? The power of social media, we hear about that all the time. But it does work, right? And the big thing is, if you want to change behavior, you shame them, right? And it can get some real momentum. You know, I didn't even know this was a thing, but I recently heard about this thing called cancel culture, and this is big in the celebrity world. And to cancel someone, basically, we're talking about, say, a well-known person, and to cancel them, it means we're going to stop giving our support to them. According to Webster's, the act of canceling would entail boycotting, say, an actor's movies or no longer reading or promoting a writer's work. And the reason they've done that is either they've said something or done something that you object to, right? And so now to try to change things, you go through this cancel culture. We're boycotting them. That is not what church discipline is all about. Church discipline is recognizing that this world is not all that there is. We are children of God. This, I love it here in New Hamburg, but this is not our home, right? And this is how that truth relates to church discipline. We are called to a better place. And our life today needs to reflect the reality of our tomorrow. This past week, it was so interesting, the timing of it. Paul Tripp in his blogs, I get that weekly, he said this. He says, you know, if you poll the average citizen, most people would say they believe in an afterlife. And in a church, he said, that would be unanimous, right? We believe in an afterlife. The problem is, and here's the thing, eternity doesn't seem to mean much to us functionally. It's not formative in the way that we are doing life. And paraphrasing Tripp, he says, you know, basically when someone's life is going sideways, what we are really trying to do is give eternity back to them. Not in terms of salvation, we're not talking about that, but we need to try help them consider what their life looks like when viewed through the lens of forever. And church discipline is a way that we can together help each other to make good choices in light of eternity. You know, maybe for some of you, the reason that you've kind of chosen to do life what I call under the radar, you know, people at arm's length, no one really sees what's going on. Maybe one of the reasons that you're doing that is that you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ. And you like being connected with kind of like a Christian tribe. You like that vibe, right? But you're concerned. You don't really want your true affections to come out. So one of the ways that you do that is you keep people at arm's length. Never let them see too closely. And if that's you, understand that if you die without Christ, you have no advocate. If you die without Christ as your Lord, you have no Savior. And your eternal destiny is hell. And after you're dead, there's no coming back. The decision is done. Your time to change is gone. And so church discipline shouldn't really be a worry for you. You need to be concerned about God's wrath. And for those of you, and probably the majority of you that are taking the time to listen, you have committed your life to Jesus Christ. And so my appeal to you is to make it your goal to allow the gospel to further penetrate your life. Because without that, our flesh will want to go another way. But praise God. I know this is a heavy topic, but praise God that He has given us each other to help us as we want to live life in light of eternity. Heavenly Father, we just thank You for what the new life that You have given us. We thank You, Lord, that our eternal destiny is not in question. Lord, if we have committed our life to You, we are always Your children. And Lord, but we know that there is a challenge to bring glory to You in our everyday life. There's just this battle waging. And we thank You for, Lord, the scripture making it very clear You want a pure church. We thank You, Lord, that You have ordained this way in which we can help each other to live life in a way that would please You. And Lord, so whoever's listening, if there's someone listening that hasn't committed their life to Jesus Christ, I pray that they would do so today. And if there's someone that is born again, Lord, but they're just trying to duck and dodge accountability because they don't want to change, I just pray that You would change their heart and change their affections. And Lord, help us to always be searching ourselves, Lord, because we know it's so easy to fall. But we praise You and we thank You for the power and the strength that we have through our resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you once again for tuning in. If these messages are speaking to you, we'd love to hear from you. If maybe this is a time where you have committed your life to Jesus Christ, let us know. We'd be so encouraged by that, and we'd try to help you any way that we can. So we've got another song before we close, and we look forward to seeing you another time. God bless.
Shining in the light of your glory, around.